If you like the video, please don't forget to subscribe and press the bell icon to get notified on every new upload.
Assalamu alaikum. Today we are going to study about orthopedic appliances, and I cannot tell you how happy I'm feeling today. It's like the feeling of coming back home after so many days from the college, because I'm recording this video after such a long time. I tell you, it's been weeks that I've recorded a lecture before, and I'm sorry because I have been very busy with lots of work going on, but let's just do it, okay? Now, the first question that should come in our mind is, what is orthopedic therapy? So, orthopedic therapy, it is aimed at the correction of skeletal imbalance. So, what we do in orthopedic therapy, our aim is to correct the skeletal, I'm just writing skeletal. It is aimed at the correction of skeletal imbalance. And in this therapy, the correction of the dentoalveolar malocclusion is of less importance. Means, we are just focused on correcting the skeletal problems, but the problems that are in the teeth, they are given less importance. So, this is the aim of orthopedic therapy. So, orthopedic therapy is aimed at the correction of skeletal imbalance. With the correction of any dentoalveolar malocclusion, means involving the teeth obviously, it is of less importance, okay? So in this therapy, little or no tooth movement is desired, okay? Now the second question which should come in your mind, and it is in my mind, is how is orthopedic therapy different from orthodontic therapy, okay? We have been knowing this term since long, orthodontic therapy. And how does orthopedic therapy differ from orthodontic therapy? So there are two differences. First difference we already studied in here. In orthopedic therapy, what we aim is the correction of skeletal problem, okay? And in orthodontic therapy, our aim is to correct the dentoalveolar malocclusion. Now, the second difference is the force. In orthopedic therapy, the force is heavier than 400 grams. Okay, so we are applying much more force in orthopedic therapy than we would in orthodontic therapy. In orthodontic therapy, the force is around 5200 grams. So you can see it is much less compared to the force we are applying in the orthopedic therapy. Okay. Now, how to manage skeletal problem? What are the various ways we can manage skeletal problem? So, there are three approaches to the management of skeletal problem. First one is the growth modification. Then we have the camouflage treatment. And then we have the surgical correction. Growth modification, it simply implies that the child is growing. He or she is in the growing phase. And we are utilizing that growth, and we are redirecting that growth. That is the growth modification we are doing. So we are redirecting the child's growth to get an appropriate result. Now the second one is camouflage treatment. Camouflage is like mimicking something. So in camouflage treatment, though we have some problems, we could have some skeletal problems, but still we are getting, you know, the proper alignment or proper look of the patient by aligning the teeth. And then in surgical correction, we do surgery, like the orthognathic surgeries. So these are the three approaches to management of a skeletal problem. Now, basis for orthopedic appliances. Okay, so what does orthopedic appliance do? We have our teeth here. So orthopedic appliances make use of the teeth as a handle. So they will utilize the teeth as a handle, and by help of this, they will transmit the force to the underlying skeletal structure. So we have all the skeletal structures there. So it will transmit forces to the underlying skeletal structure, and forces in excess of 400 grams, as already studied, should be applied to bring about favorable skeletal change. As I told, orthopedic appliances make use of teeth as a handle to transmit forces to the underlying skeletal structure. Forces in excess of 400 gram should be applied to bring about favorable skeletal change. And the treatment result depends on the following. It depends on the amount of force, the duration of force, the direction of force, the age of the patient, and the timing of the force application. So let us see each of them one by one. Okay, amount of force. So the amount of force should be high, at least as studied, 400 grams or between 400 to 600 grams per side, to a maximum total of 2 to 3 pounds, to make sure that only skeletal and no dental movement take place. So the amount of force should be, you know, high enough that we get the result, but we should also make sure that only skeletal and no dental movement take place. Next is the duration of force. The extraoral appliances should be worn for about 12 to 14 hours per day to bring about desired effect. So it should be worn for about 12 to 14 hours per day. Now we come to the direction of force. Now, direction of force application should be such as to maximize the skeletal effect. So this is, you know, a general statement about which we are going to study further in detail as we proceed. Now we have age of the patient. Orthopedic appliances, as we know, they will be most effective in the mixed dentition period because it is taking advantage of the growth spurt. And to be precise, it is taking advantage of the prepubertal growth spurt. And the prepubertal growth spurt in the females is around 11 to 12 years of age, and in the males it is 13 to 15 years of age. So this is the age where we have growth spurt, or, you know, sudden increase in the growth in males in 13 to 15 years, and in the female it is 11 to 12 years, and that is the prepubertal growth spurt. So the age of the patient, they are most effective if they are used in the mixed dentition period because it is taking advantage of the prepubertal growth spurt. Now, timing of force application. So we have evidences that suggest that there is increase in the release of growth hormones more during the evening and night and is associated with the sleep onset. So evidence says that more growth hormones are released during evening and night. So during this time, this force application will be more effective. So that is why we advise the child to wear the headgear in the evening and throughout the night. Now coming to the orthopedic appliances, we have three orthopedic appliances about which we are going to study today. These are the headgears, the face mask, and the chin cup. So coming to the headgear first, so these are ideally indicated in patients with excessive horizontal growth of maxilla. This is our maxilla, let's suppose. So the maxilla, which is having excessive horizontal growth, this is the horizontal plane. Let me change the color. So this is the horizontal plane, this is the vertical plane. So the maxilla, which is growing excessively in the horizontal plane, in that cases, we are using the headgear. And also, we have some protrusion of the maxillary teeth. So we have some protrusion. I tried to show protrusion, but yeah, now it's looking like a protrusion. So the headgear is indicated in patient with excessive horizontal growth of the maxilla with or without vertical change, along with some protrusion of maxillary teeth. And other indication is that we should have reasonably good mandibular, dental, and skeletal morphology. Means our mandible should be good enough. Okay, let's see the components. We have three components in the headgear. We have a force delivering unit, which includes the face bow and the J-hook. Means the face bow and the J-hook, they will deliver the force. And we have the force generating unit. If we have to deliver force, first we should have the force, obviously. So the force should be generated by something, and that something is the force generating unit. Then we have the anchor unit. Anchor unit means it will keep the thing stable. So we have the head cap and the neck strap as the anchor unit. Okay, coming on to the face bow. So what does the face bow do? It delivers the extra oral force to the posterior teeth. And it has certain parts. It has the outer bow, the whisker bow. So this is the outer bow. Then we have the inner bow. So this is the inner bow. And then we have the junction. So this is the junction where these two bow are joining the junction. So we have parts, three parts, outer bow, inner bow, and the junction. Now coming to the outer bow, which is also called the whisker bow. So it is made up of round stainless steel wire, and just to let you know, the dimensions are 0.051 inch or 0.062 inch in dimension, and it could be of three type. The outer bow could be of three type. It could be short. So here we have a short one. It could be medium. We have a medium bow here. Medium. And it could be long. So we have a long bow here. So in the short one, as you can see, the outer bow is shorter than the inner bow. In the medium, the outer bow is the same length as the inner bow, and in the long, the outer bow is longer than the inner bow. Now let's see the inner bow. Here we have the inner bow. It is made up of, just to let you know again, 0.045 inches or 0.052 inches round stainless steel wire. It is made up of this much dimension of wire, and it inserts into the round buccal tube on the maxillary first molar. So if you can imagine your arch here, these will be the anterior teeth, and here we'll have the posterior teeth. So it will insert into the round buccal tube, which is placed on the maxillary first molar. Now coming to the junction. Junction, as we know, it is the point of attachment to the inner and the outer bow. So you can either solder it or you can weld it. Okay, next we have the force generating unit. So this connects the face bow to the anchor unit and delivers the force to the teeth and the underlying skeletal structure. So the force element could be springs or elastics. You can see in the diagram here. Now the anchor unit. The anchor unit is in the form of head cap or neck strap. You can see in these images, and it makes use of anchorage from the skull or the back of the neck. Here you can see skull is used, here neck is used, or a combination. You can see in this case a combination has been used. Okay, so this one, it is the occipital headgear. This one is the cervical headgear. This one, it is a combination because it is utilizing both of them, the neck as well as the occiput. So it is the combination. And this one, it is the high pull headgear. This is the high pull. Okay, the head cap or the cervical strap. Now coming on to the headgears, it could be divided into two types. They could be divided as follows: according to direction of force and according to the location of the anchor unit. So according to the direction of force, they could be distal force, mesial force. According to the location, it could be cervical pull, occipital pull, As we had seen in the previous images, it could be cervical pull, occipital pull, high pull, and the combination pull. Now let's see the cervical headgear. So here you can see the anchor unit in this headgear is the nape of the neck. So here the anchor unit is the nape of the neck, and what it does, it causes extrusion and distalization of molars along with distal movement of maxilla. Let us see. This is our maxilla. Let's suppose this is our molars, very horrible molar. So it will cause extrusion as well as distalization, means going towards the posterior side, along with the distal movement of maxilla. So it is doing three things. It is causing extrusion, and it is causing distalization, as well as it is causing distal movement of the maxilla. Now let us see the indications. So it is indicated in short face class 2 maxillary protrusive cases with a low mandibular plane angle and a deep bite. Okay, obviously in class 2 maxillary protrusive cases, you have the maxilla forwardly placed, so we want to pull the maxilla backward. All right, also indicated for anchorage conservation. The forward movement can be resisted better if the anchor molars are supported further using the forces generated by the cervical headgear. So what we are doing, we are, you know, resisting the forward movement. We are using the molars to, you know, we are supporting the molars by the cervical headgear, and with the help of the molar, we are not allowing the forward movement. Okay, now let us see more indication. So this is also indicated for the early treatment of class 2 malocclusion, as it helps to distalize the maxilla and correct the class 2 molar relationship. Obviously class 2 for the early treatment of class 2. All right, now contraindications. It is contraindicated in open bite cases. It is contraindicated in high mandibular plane angle and in the long face cases with an increase in lower anterior facial height.